Braver, Jane, president of Province 5, delegates and friends, I just had a great time being with you at your convention, and I am truly grateful for the honor of receiving the James Kelsey Justice and Peace Award. I had the honor of knowing Jim, and I actually, you may not know this, Lydia, I read the citation and handed him his honorary doctorate from the Episcopal Divinity School just a short while before his tragic and untimely death. And he was a great bishop and an even greater person in spite of his love for those Yankees. Jim had a vision of who we could be, and he worked toward that vision with boundless energy and commitment. He was a beacon of hope in our church and our world, and along with all of you, and especially you, Lydia, I miss him. When Bishop Rayford and I spoke about my time with you, he suggested I take a few minutes and renegotiate and reflect with you. He gave me the topic, which is to reflect with you about the shift in who we are becoming in the Episcopal Church, especially the shift that has occurred during the past decade, the time concurrent with when I served as president of the House of Deputies. So, organizational identity. No, I'm not a social scientist, but I've gotten into organizational identity. And it's been described as what is central, enduring, and what are the distinctive features of an organization such as a church. Identity changes over time, with some features staying the same and other features changing or evolving. And some changes happen really quickly, very rapidly. I mean, who could have imagined the way, the changes in the way we worship in the past 2.5 years? Some changes take a lot longer and evolve slowly over time, such as the full inclusion of women in the governance of our church. We've moved from, and this is my favorite title of any committee ever established by General Convention, we've moved from the Joint Commission to consider the problem of giving the women of the church a voice in the legislation of the General Convention. That's the actual name. Established by General Convention in 1949. Who could have imagined we'd move then to the 1991 election of Pamela Pauly Chinnis as the first woman? You were there, Dick was there, as the president of the House of Deputies. She had been the president of the Episcopal Church Women's Triennial. And then in 2006, the election of Catherine Jefferts Shorey to serve as presiding bishop. So here are just a couple of the things I've seen in the past decade. During this past 10 years, during this decade, the church has deepened its commitment to interrogate, and I use that word specifically, to interrogate our church's role in slavery, exploitation, and colonialism. Significant resources have been committed to racial equity, racial justice, and racial reconciliation during this decade, including the most recent General Convention resolution to establish the Episcopal Coalition for Racial Equity and Justice. We have only just begun this work, and it will not be completed in my lifetime. When I say we've only begun, I think especially of our indigenous siblings. Yes, we repudiated the doctrine of discovery at General Convention in 2009, and there have been subsequent resolutions in an effort to deepen our commitment to this work, but frankly, progress has been slow. This summer, however, the deputies and bishops at General Convention called the church to tell the truth, and I'm so glad to hear what you are beginning to hear, to tell the truth about the Episcopal Church's history with indigenous boarding schools, but it went further. It also acknowledged the intergenerational trauma caused by the doctrine of discovery, colonialism, genocide, ethnocide through the operation of indigenous boarding schools, and other systems of white supremacy that have oppressed indigenous peoples. Acknowledgement is a start, but acknowledgement alone will never be enough. We have years of work ahead of us to turn acknowledgement into action, and I pray it may be so. Next thing. The full inclusion of our two-spirit LGBTQIA plus siblings has largely been settled, at least in our governing documents, in the past decade, although there remain pockets of resistance. Equal marriage was made possible at General Convention in 2015. Now, to the chagrin of many in the Anglican Communion, which we are part, we just keep ordaining two-spirit LGBTQIA plus deacons, priests, and bishops, and we keep baptizing everyone, which is the true reason we ordain our two-spirit LGBTQIA plus siblings, because if you are baptized and welcomed into the household of God, there is nothing you cannot do when called by God in the community. But you already knew that here in Northern Michigan. We're finally living into a relationship with the Anglican Communion that has integrity. 10 years ago, we were paralyzed by the fear of getting kicked out of the Anglican Communion if we moved ahead on marriage equality and full inclusion. And that's no longer the case. We are no longer paralyzed by that fear. We know who we are as a church, and we are unwavering in our commitment to the full inclusion and participation of all our members. Now, all of this happened in the midst of a sea change throughout the Episcopal Church, with church-wide membership between 2011 and 2020 decreasing 17%, down by 25% in my province and yours, Province 5. It's not because of the two issues I just talked about. That's not why. The landscape's changed. There are many fewer people in this post-Christendom era, compounded by the global COVID-19 pandemic, which has resulted in the loss of more people for a whole host of reasons. I just want to note for the treasurer. Where's the treasurer? There's the treasurer. He probably already knows this. The average pledge in the Episcopal Church between 2016 and 2022 was up 16%. And in Northern Michigan, the increase was 22%. Fewer people, yet greater commitment to stewardship. So let me conclude by honoring you. For you have not lost hope. You have not lost heart. I'm especially heartened by your commitment to dismantling racism, misogyny, homophobia, clericalism, and all the interlocking oppressions that are antithetical to the gospel work to which we're called. Your justice work, your groundbreaking work in baptismal theology and ministry, your hiring of Leora, Director of Diversity, Equity and Inclusion, might be one of the first in the Episcopal Church. I believe so. I believe you've been in partnership Your commitment to the use of land acknowledgments, and not just acknowledgement, but moving to action. I loved hearing about Soul Shop. I am one of those people. My daughter died by suicide 12 years, still 12 years. And my favorite thing that you've done is your refusal to put a crown on your bishop's head. And his refusal to crown himself. Bishop Tarrant has made you, Rayford, a true model of true episcopacy and what it means to be a bishop in this church. The gift of God that is in you from the laying on